Hi, Jeff Frick here from theCUBE offices in Palo Alto, California, welcoming you to a special CUBE conversation that we're going to have today on Bitcoin. As you may have seen last week, Greg Stewart and I took theCUBE gear out to Stanford Stadium to cover the California Classico, the fourth annual contest between the San Jose Earthquakes of Major League Soccer versus the LA Galaxy. It's a big event game. They have it at Stanford Stadium. 50,000 people showed up, a lot of pomp and circumstance, parachutes, etc. But we went out there as theCUBE to really see what impact tech was having on the game, on the fan experience, etc. Really a follow-up to the conversation we had with David Covell at Sports Data SV at AT&T Park earlier this year. So we had a great time going out there, but one of the interesting innovations that we covered was the Earthquakes' introduction of Bitcoin, both as a way for fans to purchase merchandise right there out of the little fan merchandise cart, as well as tickets. So we met with Richard Fidesco, who was the Senior Director of Business Intelligence and Sports Science for the Earthquakes. A great little interview. He's doing not only Bitcoin, but other things, and I think you'll find it of interest. We're going to roll the interview and then have some conversations with Mark Rizzn Hopkins, our own internal Dr. Bitcoin, after this segment. So we'll run the segment. Greg's got it queued up, and we'll be right back. Welcome back. This is Jeff Frick here from theCUBE. We're out at Stanford Stadium for the San Jose Earthquakes versus the LA Galaxy, the California Classico.
Absolutely.
And I'm here with Rich Fidesco, Senior Director of Business Intelligence. Yep. Rich, thanks for spending a few minutes with us.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Awesome. So what Rich is working on, which we thought was pretty interesting, we know the audience is really interested in, is Bitcoin, right? A lot of talk about Bitcoin. There's a lot of speculation about Bitcoin. What's Bitcoin? People doing crazy back alley stuff with Bitcoin. But here, what can you buy with Bitcoin from the Earthquakes?
You can buy any merchandise you want. We partner with Coinbase, so anybody that has Bitcoin, they can just download the Coinbase wallet. From there, they just go to our merch stand here, pick out whatever they want, and it's a really simple, probably like 1 minute transaction, just really, really similar to credit cards and whatnot. We have a tablet that we just punch in the amounts, and from there, all you're doing is scanning your phone with the encrypted Bitcoin amount, and with the push of a button, you send the Bitcoin to us, and we send a receipt, and there you go. You have your merchandise with Bitcoin.
So talk a little bit about this initiative. I don't know that I've ever heard anyone taking Bitcoin at the stadium, and I'm a huge sports fan. I go to a lot of games. So where did this come from? Was it initiated from the fan base? Was it some innovation internally? What kind of made this happen?
It was a combination. I mean, for us, I mean, Dave Cavill, our president, really interested. He understands, and as an organization, we understand we're in Silicon Valley. You know, this is the hub. This is the incubator for technology, and Bitcoin is obviously an interesting piece to that. And you know, I know that in Palo Alto here, there's coffee shops that take Bitcoin and whatnot, and it just, you know, we talked to Coinbase, who kind of brought it to our attention that it was a relatively easy transaction, and we partnered with them, and they've been a great partner with us to, you know, make it a seamless, easy opportunity for our fans. And you know, we've done it a month ago at our last home game. We had 15 to 20 transactions, and we have a ton of people taking signs of we accept Bitcoin and stuff. So there's definitely a lot of interest and a lot of curiosity. So it's been great so far, and we're interested to see where it's going to go, and with the new stadium, the opportunity's there.
Yeah, it's one of the things why we like the Earthquakes is because you guys are so progressive, right? 15 to 20 transactions, not a big transactions, probably didn't cover the cost of putting the systems in, but it's innovation, it's excitement, it changes the flavor, people like it.
Absolutely. I mean, I think that right now, yeah, you're seeing 15 to 20 transactions. We haven't really promoted it too much, but we think there's an opportunity for it to continue to grow, and it is an interesting thing, another thing for our fans to try out and just get a taste of in real world transactions. People hear about Bitcoin, we're kind of educating our fan base a little bit, and they're educating us in regards to if they want to do it or not.
Yeah, so talk a little bit about the transaction itself, because most of the buzz, or a lot of the buzz about Bitcoin, is about the way that the price moves and fluctuates, and is it a speculation vehicle, and what's going on. How do you work with that? I just want to buy a $20 hat or a $100 jersey. How does that work?
Well, it's pretty simple. I mean, you buy the Bitcoin, and you know, right now they're trading for like $550 or something like that. You can buy partial things, but you go on, you download the Coinbase app. You can buy Bitcoin via Coinbase, and then from there, you know, during the time that you're buying it, you know, the day of purchase, there's a dollar a figure assigned to it. So on our end, all we're doing is using the Coinbase merchant app. We're just typing in the price of the actual merchandise, and it's then generating the actual price that, in Bitcoin. And from there, the fan is scanning it, and then they accept that this is how much it costs, and this is the Bitcoin equivalent, and then it transfers to us. And for us, because of Coinbase, you know, they're actually the intermediary. As the earthquakes, we don't really want to, you know, deal with the fluctuating market as much. So Coinbase allows it to immediately, at that point of transaction, deposit into our bank account in the cash equivalent that we sold our merchandise in. So
right.
We can make sure the $20 hat is, you know, we're getting $20 and not, you know, waiting and, you know, the next day and all of a sudden it's, you know, maybe dropped a little bit or you know, it'd be nice if it went up, but if it goes down, we don't want to, you know, worry about the fluctuating market.
Right. So, Rich, your title, Senior Director of Business Intelligence. So I want to shift gears a little bit away from Bitcoin and talk about some of the other business intelligence initiatives that you guys are doing to help the fan experience, to help run the organization from the team perspective or from the business perspective. What are some of the initiatives and things you guys are working on?
Well, I mean, for us, I mean, we're obviously big data, you know, really looking at all the analytics across the board. Over the last year, we've implemented a new CRM system, Microsoft Dynamics, and used other software, you know, our ticketing system, tickets.com, along with, you know, pulling in different marketing initiatives that all, you know, we want everything to talk to each other so we can get a full picture of the fan, what they're doing, and then as an organization, understanding, you know, the full picture of cost and profits, you know, everything going into one. On the fan side, we're, for next year at the new stadium, we're going to be launching a new stadium app, which we hope will be a great leap forward for our fans. We're really pushing mobile ticketing, so that, you know, the hub of that will be allowing our season ticket holders and our people who buy on the web to start out with, allow them to, you know, literally have their mobile phone and that's all they need. They can, you know, we're partnering with Parking Panda, so people can buy their parking, reserve their parking using their phone, and then actually have it right there so an attendant can scan it. Then they can walk into the stadium or go to the, you know, as they're walking in, their ticket will pop up. They'll have the ability to scan their ticket. And then inside, we'll have more, we'll have some push notifications or some geofencing type things to, again, help fans understand where things are and potentially do some other things as well.
Geofencing. Geofencing. There's a new one. So I just want to kind of follow up on that. Talk about the innovation of the company. What is it about the earthquakes and how do you foster an environment where you can really drive this kind of innovation? What's kind of the secret? What's the process? Why do you guys continue to try to stay out on that cutting edge?
You know, it's a top-down. You know, Dave came in, our president, and he laid it out there. He says that, you know, he told us, you know, we're in Silicon Valley. You know, there's a lot of other great ballparks out there. I mean, the Giants, AT&T Park, obviously Levi's is going to open up, you know, in August. We're actually going to be the first event there.
We hope to be there with you.
Yeah, that'll be great. But, you know, like, it's important for us, you know, to connect to the community. And the community here in Silicon Valley is, you know, innovation, technology centric. And so, you know, that was the initiative put out there, and we are trying to follow through and listen to the fans, you know, at our current stadium, which isn't great, but we're even doing, you know, we have mobile, you know, allow people to buy food and merchandise on their phone and get it delivered to them at games. So that was, you know, we really understood that our fans are tech savvy and they want this, and for us to be, you know, good business people and to, you know, make sure our fans keep coming back, we have to feed that and keep pushing the envelope, and that's it's critical for us as an organization.
And is he charging you with like assigning 10% of your time to do something new? Are you, you know, carousing the league? I mean, you know, talk about kind of down in the weeds. How do you keep coming up with new things? Is it huge steps forward? Are you just continual innovation?
A lot of it, honestly, Dave has amazing connections. He was here, you know, he's a Stanford grad. We're in Silicon Valley. There's so many startups. And Dave is on so many different boards. He's constantly getting all these different startups and you know, organizations that really want to push technology, you know, coming to him. And then what ends up happening is he'll then kind of direct them to me, and I sit down with, you know, 10, you know, I'm on the phone or in-person meetings with, you know, like 10 or 15 of these probably a week, and, you know, trying to understand realistically, is there an opportunity? How far along are they? You know, we love being beta clients for different opportunities because, you know, it's an opportunity to learn from people that really want to, you know, do it and push forward. And also, you know, it's costly for us. It doesn't cost us very much, you know, to help them. So for us, you know, we're really constantly talking to these startups and understanding what people are pushing. You know, like they're telling us what the crowd and what people want innovation-wise. And so from there, I'm kind of sifting through and seeing realistically what might make sense for the organization, what might not. And you know, from that, we've gotten these different opportunities, the Yorder, which is the seat, ordering at your seat and whatnot, different things in our app that we'll be doing. You know, I mentioned geofencing. There's other, you know, things out there as well. I mean, we're gonna be working with Nomi, which is another, you know, company that does mobile and things as well. So like, it really is, I mean, a lot of connections, a lot of people just telling us that, hey, here's different options for you, and us sitting down and seeing if they make sense and trying to work with them, because a lot of them have good ideas and some of them are going places, and for those that are, we want to be a part of it.
Yeah, that's great. And I'm sure some percentage of those things, you know, wash out or doesn't work out.
Absolutely.
But really a great, you know, kind of culture of innovation to listen, take the call, hear what people have to say, and
yeah,
give it a try.
Absolutely. Now, we love interacting and talking and learning. So it's been great. Anybody else out there that has these great ideas, we're always looking for them.
Awesome. So Rich Fedesco, thanks for stopping by at theCUBE, telling us a little bit about Bitcoin. Greg's behind the camera, he's gonna buy a hat. I know he's got some Bitcoin burning a hole in his pocket. Senior Director of Business Intelligence. Good luck tonight.
Appreciate it.
And we look forward to hoping to see you at Levi's and then at the new stadium,
awesome.
I guess in March, right?
Absolutely.
All right, great.
To.
Thanks a lot. Much. All right, take care.
Well, great. Welcome back. So I hope you enjoyed that segment with Richard. I thought it was pretty informative, and we'd like to introduce for the next part of this show, calling in from Dallas, Mark Rizzn Hopkins, the founding editor of SiliconANGLE, and also the writer of the popular blog post, Dr. Bitcoin. So Mark, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, yes.
Great. So I don't know if you'd seen that before. I'd love to get your reaction to the interview with Richard.
Oh yeah, well, I mean, I'd watched it when it hit the YouTube channel. I'd missed the last couple minutes of it where he was the first watch through when he was talking about geofencing. That was an interesting thing. I actually use geofencing with my limited. I've been working on automating my home, and so I've used like a little thing whenever the family gets to the house, we turn on the Nest thermostat with a geofence. And but I hadn't seen any like commercial application of that, so it's kind of cool to see that them kind of applying technology innovation across the board.
Yeah, so it's interesting to note. I don't know that I would consider the earthquakes to be, you know, a very you know, big brand, obviously, a real reflection of kind of mainstream adoption of Bitcoin. But I wonder if it is, if not a mainstream, certainly part of a leading indicator. And before the call, you shared some sites of some other companies that are starting to take Bitcoin. Obviously, we all saw the Tesla announcement. They made a bunch of noise earlier in the year. But I wonder if you can talk a little bit about how the adoption of Bitcoin as a payment method is starting to gain traction in the marketplace, and who are some of the other examples that you can cite?
Yeah, so I mean, you're seeing two types of commercial Bitcoin adopters, and you're seeing it not just like as in company types, but as in types of in ways they adopt. And he talked about the way in the segment, he talked about the way that they handle the Bitcoin transaction and the price volatility, and they allow Coinbase essentially to take to de-risk it for them and immediately deposit the cash equivalent of the Bitcoin as the transaction occurs, or the day the transaction occurs, so they don't have to worry about, you know, Bitcoin losing a dollar or gaining 10 or whatever, and you know, having to account for that in their business models. So that right there in my mind is one type of Bitcoin adopter, and you're seeing a few of those. You're seeing, I think, the Kings adopt that model as well. You're seeing probably, no, I haven't heard word from this, but I've heard, I think 1-800-Flowers is most likely doing that as well. Companies that allow Coinbase and BitPay and other middleman transaction merchant services companies that facilitate Bitcoin are tending to do this sort of thing. They allow these companies to kind of act as a PayPal for them, and not really let BitPay and Coinbase assume the risk, and then not hold Bitcoin. And then you're seeing folks like Overstock.com, like Tesla, like let's see, well, Newegg just announced this week, and of course Tiger Direct has been around for a little while, where you're seeing these companies where they're in varying degrees going whole hog into the Bitcoin ecosystem, and not only holding Bitcoin from customer transactions, but also trying to set up their supply chain to accept Bitcoin, so that they don't have to change in and out of multiple currencies. They can just live in a Bitcoin-centric world and change it into other currency types as need arises.
So it's interesting because one of the main tenets of a Bitcoin economy or a cyber currency economy is the fact that there is no trusted intermediary required, that basically the encryption algorithm fulfills that role. So is that kind of breakdown in the example that the earthquakes use, where you are using Coinbase as kind of that trusted third party intermediary?
Yeah, I wouldn't say it breaks down, but it definitely it mitigates the benefit to a certain extent. I mean, Bitcoin is still fundamentally decentralized, but the way Bitcoin is served up to the user with services like, and by user, I mean merchant in this case, the way it's served up to the user is in a centralized sort of way. Now, there are other kinds of web wallets that are out there and web merchant services that are more, I guess you could say, Bitcoin native. But Coinbase in particular kind of serves as like a Bitcoin bank. Like they basically have a virtual vault where the Bitcoins are stored and secured, and it creates a central point of attack, I guess, so to speak. If Coinbase goes out of business, so goes the hoard of Bitcoins. And they have been certified by a lot of kind of experts in security as being a trustable company. I certainly don't want to speak ill of them, but at the end of the day, you do have to trust them. Whereas Bitcoin, you have to trust the algorithm, not a company.
So I've got a theory I want to run by you, and I ask it on most of my Bitcoin conversations. But it seems to me when you have a dollar in your wallet, that there's three purposes potentially for that dollar. One is just a way to hold value, so you can carry it around. The second way is to exchange value for a burrito or whatever else you're trying to buy. And the third value is really the speculative value of that unit versus other ways of holding a value, whether it be a euro, another currency, a Bitcoin, et cetera. And it seems to me that on the Bitcoin side, there's just a lot of activity, noise, discussion around the speculative nature of the way the price has fluctuated quite wildly at times versus the former two ways, holding value and trading value, that I think is ultimately the best role that a currency can play. So to me, it seems like the adoption of Bitcoin will accelerate when there's less emphasis on the speculative piece in terms of making money on the raise in value of a Bitcoin versus an alternative way, an anonymous way to hold value and exchange value. So I wonder if you've got any opinions on that perception, and can you validate, are we moving more towards the discussion around holding value and exchanging value versus the speculative nature as an alternative currency to dollars?
Yeah, certainly. I mean, and Bitcoin, there's a million. You could sit around all day and discuss all the interesting aspects and what makes Bitcoin unique. And I think that's the first thing you have to address when you talk about Bitcoin, is the fact that this is really like no other financial instrument that's ever existed, because it reduces so many would have kind of been like ivory tower functions, banking functions that were reserved for a small subset of the populace, the banking elite, and it puts it in the hands of everybody. So that speculation is no longer just a few thousand people that live on Wall Street or that work on Wall Street in New York City and other financial centers around the world. It's the whole planet that you know, has an interest in Bitcoin can now speculate on it. So that does unique things to any market, you know, let alone Bitcoin market. So, but putting that aside for a second, I think that we are progressing towards a more mature, you know, cryptocurrency market. I think by virtue of the fact you're seeing such large and increasingly risk-averse companies. I mean, Tesla, which was one of the first major brands to accept Bitcoin, you can call them many things, but risk-averse is not one of them. But you look at a company like Newegg, which has been around for a decade and a half. That's a significant risk for them. Like they're putting a business on the line, a currency that hasn't been tested in the courts, how the IRS is going to react to, you know, certain accounting practices. I mean, they've said what they want to do, but, you know, there's not a lot of precedent for that. Things can certainly change because it's early days. But because of the benefits, particularly for merchants, you're seeing a lot of increasingly risk-averse companies jump into Bitcoin. And I think... as the price goes up, because of speculation, you're going to see less and less emphasis on speculation. And the reason why is, anybody on a minimum wage salary could have bought in on Bitcoin, maybe dropped $500 on Bitcoin in 2009, 2010, and today they could, you know, buy their own yacht in a small island in the Caribbean, right? That can never happen again. You know, the price of Bitcoin right now is in the 600s. That puts Bitcoin fundamentally out of the price range of the average Joe, you know, and so they can't. There's not a temptation or this possibility of everybody, you know, speculating and becoming an overnight millionaire. I mean, yes, there are significant gains to be made as Bitcoin progresses, but you're going to see that that potential pool of investors and those guys, people with dollar signs in their eyes. Are going to decrease as time progresses, just because of the price of Bitcoin puts it out of the reach of the average person.
I don't know. You raise all types of interesting questions there. One is kind of the role of the government, and at the end of the day, it's going to be the taxing authority who's going to flex their muscle, as we saw with pretty much every innovation. The government, you know, wants to get their piece, especially when it comes to the taxation. And I'm wondering, in terms of the accounting, how that's taken care of, where is it tracked, has there been any interesting court cases? And the second part, which you just mentioned about the price of Bitcoin getting more expensive and kind of out of the realm of the ordinary guy, I would say that would potentially create more potential abuse as you do now kind of get back to a concentration of power, which you said originally was part of the Bitcoin issue, was to get it out of a small group of hands of control. But will that in fact happen as the price of Bitcoin gets to a point where it's going to be well-financed people that can go in and potentially, you know, move the markets either illegally, maliciously, or, you know, to their own benefit? Give us an update on what's happening with government and taxation, and specifically around merchants having to pay, you know, the sales tax back to the government, which they're going to want. And B, you know, is there now a consolidation of power based as a function of the pricing of Bitcoin that's now moving it away from, as you said, the guy making minimum wage? You can't buy any Bitcoins, at least at $600 a unit.
So, all right, I'll address the government thing first, because that's easier. That's an easier question to answer. There's been a lot of announcements this year by various government agencies, and there are two prevailing ways there's two ways, one of them prevailing, and of how the government views Bitcoin. Most government agencies, particularly when it comes to, you know, prosecuting people for violations of the law, most government agencies regard Bitcoin as a quote-unquote digital currency or a quote-unquote foreign currency. So they're regarding it in one of those two ways. And that's fairly universal around the world. Notable exceptions to that regard of Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies is China and the IRS, who the China Banking Authority have, and IRS kind of have a similar opinion that Bitcoin is a property or a commodity to be invested in. And that's how the IRS wants you to report Bitcoin. And it gets into a very complex, almost untenable way of reporting, unless you're using computer-assisted accounting. I mean, that's the only way properly report your IRS holdings, or your Bitcoin holdings to the IRS, is you're using computer-assisted accounting, some sort of weird first-in, first-out capital gains tax type situation that even I have a hard time articulating. It's really one of those consult your accountant situations and then go buy the software that makes it work right, because otherwise you're gonna owe a lot of money and be liable for a lot of money that you don't understand how to calculate. With regard to your other question, and I should say, as a kind of a bookend to that, I think there's still more quote unquote innovation in the regulation to go. The IRS clearly does not understand how Bitcoin works, or they're being intentionally obtuse to kind of push people away from it, which I don't think is working, actually. My guess is, if I had to make a prediction today, that they're going to drastically change the way that they approach the taxation of Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies down the line. And to answer your other question kind of about centralization of power, that's interesting. And I will preface anything I say that intelligent minds can disagree on this. There's a lot of discussion here, like almost philosophical discussion, certainly economic system discussion. But my personal opinion is based on a couple of facts that I can back up, is that I don't think that you'll see any kind of quote-unquote centralization of power. Not in the way that we see in the current financial markets, at any rate. And that's because the way Bitcoin is regulated, self-regulated, self-governed, it doesn't have much to do with who has the money. It has more to do with, the way the algorithm works, the way the mining markets are working, and the way the open source is being updated. So right now, if there was, let's say Bill Gates wants to come in and muck up Bitcoin, so he pays $5 billion for some open source developer just to get in and put a bunch of stuff that Bill Gates wants, it's to Bill Gates' advantage, into the Bitcoin core code. He still, even after that's done, you still have to get the buy-in of the entire Bitcoin mining community. And if it's not in their best interest to, that's thousands and thousands, if not millions of people around the world. If it's not in their best interest to, muck about in the core code of Bitcoin, then they're not going to do it. And it doesn't matter how much money Bill Gates throws at the problem. I mean, unless he throws at the problem more money than is in the entire Bitcoin ecosystem, which at that point, it's a little bit self-defeating. Now, market manipulation is another matter. Bitcoin is certainly vulnerable in that department because it is an open market, and the market cap of Bitcoin itself is below the market cap of many rich people in the world, let alone rich governments. So it is susceptible to manipulation, certainly. Over the long term, I don't see that as an issue because as an advocate or almost a almost an evangelist. I won't call myself an evangelist for Bitcoin, but as someone who's extremely interested in it and would like to see it continue, my thought is that it's going to grow. It shows so many advantages to so many people that it's going to grow bigger than any one bad actor could manipulate past. You're going to see a lot of people unorganized. Like you see like the Winklevoss, you're going to see other rich people, other investment groups jumping in. And it'll be just like any other market, all kinds of people trying to manipulate markets, but because of its decentralized nature and its almost foreign nature, right? It's not like any other, stock market on the planet. High-frequency trading isn't really a thing that the effects of HFT are much more mitigated in Bitcoin due to a number of factors than they are in actual markets or in Wall Street markets. So I think that So I think that, I guess this is just kind of a broad answer to everything, but in many ways, the effects of traditional market manipulation are just plain old mitigated due to the decentralized nature and the chaotic nature of the beast.
Yeah, I guess time will tell. What right now is the size of the Bitcoin market? How many Bitcoins are there in terms of value? You said it's less than the
Well, let me see. I can pull that figure up right now. It may take me just a second, but
and then while you're pulling that market, out, how often and what's the rate of new value being added? Not in terms of changes in the value of a Bitcoin, but in terms of new coins being mined, I guess is the right vocabulary.
Well, I mean, every 10 minutes, you've got another, it varies. So every few minutes, you get another 25 Bitcoin. So if you go to blockchain.info, you can kind of, there's a real-time updating screen there where you can see right on the top age of, let's see, this is the transaction. So you want to go to the stats. So time between blocks is roughly 8.73 minutes. It was, kind of set up to be about 10 minutes, but about every 8.73 minutes, you've got a new block of transactions that is verified by Bitcoin miners out there. And there's roughly 25 Bitcoins created with every new block. And, over time, that will decrease. That is the amount of Bitcoins created by a new block. It's on a set scale that decreases over time until we reach the maximum amount of Bitcoins that will be minted ever.
So that's already a prescribed, there's already a prescribed number that once it hits that, there's no more to be created?
21 million Bitcoins is the maximum number of Bitcoins that will ever be minted.
21 million.
Yes, and that's what makes it deflationary over time, is that like any other limited resource, as demand goes up and supply remains the same, the cost for the product will go up.
And what's to stop somebody from making the 21st million and first and one Bitcoin?
21 and, well, the core code of Bitcoin. And like I said, the core code would have to be modified, and then all Bitcoin miners and Bitcoin users that use the wallet to prevent a hard fork would have to agree to basically update everyone have to update their code to accept a change in like the supply of Bitcoin.
Okay. So looking at the trends, you follow this very closely, you watch what's going on, you're on top of the news. What is kind of the next big hill for the Bitcoin phenomenon to take in terms of its adoption or kind of mainstream adoption? What's the next significant thing that's going to happen that'll be an indication of that?
Well, I think it's going to be, so in terms of mainstream adoption, you've got to see some more brick and mortar adoption right now, and you've got to see more successes in brick and mortar. And one thing that I heard from your interview there with the earthquakes that was a little bit disappointing with me was the volume of transaction that happened there in person. What was it, like 21 transactions? Is that right? Am I remembering that number correctly?
Yeah, something like that, 15 to 20.
15 to 20, right? At what time frame was that? Was that like the day, opening day, or was that like over all time? Or
I don't know if it was per event or all time. I mean, it's a very small number, clearly. It's almost more of a PR move than it is a real business move. And it's a reflection of, I think, the earthquake's desire to be cutting edge, and they're in Silicon Valley, they want to be that way. But clearly, it's not it's not a big number. I would say it's not really meaningful.
And that was what was surprising to me, right? Because if you look at one of the articles that I sent you, and I think we cover this at SiliconANGLE as well, was CoinDesk. They wrote an article on Overstock. They interviewed CEO Patrick Byrne. 1.6 million in Bitcoin sales over the course of a weekend or the week. It was like the first time period that they were reporting earnings for after they accepted Bitcoin, which is a massive number. And that was what stunned everybody and kind of got other legitimate brands interested in paying attention to Bitcoin. Again, Overstock is an online-only brand, right? So they're playing to a global market. you know, that I think, so when you ask me what's the next big hurdle for Bitcoin for on its way to mainstream adoption, is there has to be a solid brick and mortar win, right? You're seeing, as particularly in Silicon Valley, which is surprising to me, you're seeing Bitcoin brick and mortar adoption lagging. There are other cities that we visit on the spring tour with theCUBE that had a lot more Bitcoin. Las Vegas has more Bitcoin adoption than certain cities in Silicon Valley. Which, you know, is interesting, maybe not surprising given the gambling aspect of things, but it's definitely interesting. And so once those successes start to get reported with brick and mortar and become more widely widely known about, then I think you're going to see that's going to be the next big uptick. And the other major watershed event that's going to have to happen is the realization of the value of supply chain integration with Bitcoin. And that is, I mean, because one of the main benefits for Bitcoin for a merchant is avoiding chargebacks. I mean, plain and simple, that could be like up to 20% or more for other businesses of the cost of running the business is chargebacks. And Bitcoin eliminates that because it's an irreversible transaction, just like cash. So once you see that's great. But once you see integration of a company that does accept Bitcoin, where they're not just buying it and cashing it out the dollar, but holding it and then using it to pay their suppliers with, and thereby avoiding even more banking fees, you're going to see a lot more adoption across the board once the realization of the benefits of B2B Bitcoin as opposed to B2C.
It's interesting. I think for that to happen, it's got to be much more steady in its value fluctuation, because if, you know, most merchants, not big ones obviously, but a lot of them, you know, are not in the business of arbitraging currency, and that's a very different business than buying and selling t-shirts or buying and selling groceries. So I think once the volatility of the pricing reduces, and so that it becomes a little bit better, a little bit more consistent holder of value, then potentially you'll see more adoption of actually holding Bitcoin and doing more back-end transactions on Bitcoin versus kind of a front-end novelty, which it still seems to be at a lot of these places, obviously not all of them. And then I think, too, at 21 million, it's not a big number in terms of if this thing ever really rocks and rolls, so it'll be interesting to see if that ever gets readdressed, but we've been running long.
You don't need to have a
word here before we sign out. So
you don't. So with regard to the Bitcoin 21 million thing, you don't have to have, like, I have right now in my wallet on my phone, I've got 2.91 and a bunch of numbers past the decimal point Bitcoins. So you don't have to spend whole Bitcoins at a time, and you can even own like less than a hundredth of a Bitcoin. And if that hundredth of a Bitcoin, you know, in 15 years could be worth, you know, $5,000, right? You know, it's infinitely divisible, and that's an easy thing to make. So I don't think that's not too big of a stumbling block for Bitcoin. I don't see, they may add more decimal points as time goes on, you know, God willing. That means those that hold Bitcoin today are going to be very, very rich. But with regard to the fluctuation, there's an exact number that you can put on that, right? So 20% is kind of the average loss for a normal quote-unquote non-risky business that they lose to chargebacks. So if you see Bitcoin fluctuation not within the range of like a swing of less than 20%, then that is the exact point in which Bitcoin becomes less risky than using credit cards as a primary way of interacting financially with your customers. I mean, just that's the simple math. That's a number. That's a quantifiable number, because you're losing, you know, 20% of all value held to use credit card systems fighting bad actors. And if your price is staying relatively stable, which it is, if you look at Bitcoinity.org, which tracks the Bitcoin price historically going back 4 years, you can see the price over the last, let's see, the last 7 days and the last month has only swung, let's go look back 30 days. It's only swung 0.07% in either direction in the last 24 hours and 3% back and forth in the last 30 days. So stability is here, right? We're much more stable, you know, at Bitcoin being, you know, $600 a coin than we were back when it was $11 a coin, shooting up to 1,200 and back down to 600. I mean, this, and it's been like this for many months now. So especially given all the crazy news that's coming out of the Bitcoin world, this is remarkable that it's become this stable this quick.
Most credit card transactions are nowhere near 20. Where's the 20 coming from?
This is just like I've read reports kind of circulating around. So there was a report that the it's like kind of like a big global economy thing that the IMF put out that kind of talked about merchant accounts and remittance markets a few months ago actually, that talked about you know, how much of the world, I mean, it's like the one, it's like how many billions are in the remittance markets, and you know where the margins were on that, and you know how it was a report particularly about the opportunities for cryptocurrency, and one of the things that it mentioned was, you know, online businesses fighting chargebacks.
That's a lot higher than kind of a typical good U.S. company plays to a typical bank, but. But anyway, so there's a lot
that
of opportunity.
May have been an
things are moving.
Figure.
So thanks, Mark, for joining us. Thanks everyone else for tuning in. We will continue to update the story as we go out to talk to more merchants as Bitcoin adoption continues to increase. Thanks for Mark for joining us again. Great interview with Richard Fidesco at the Earthquakes. I'm Jeff Frick. We're CUBE Conversation, Palo Alto, California. We'll catch you next time. Thanks.